Thank you, Anaga, for this warm invitation. So the aim of this course is to actually share with you the strategies in the surgical management of a patient with a posterior polar cataract. Now, the fundamental pathology that we do have in a patient with a polar cataract is, one, you've got an abnormal opacification at the posterior pole of the lens. You've got an abnormal adhesion between that opacity and the posterior capsule. And finally, we also have an abnormal inherent fragility of the posterior capsule. This, according to me, would be the ideal technique in each step. Now, we need to pay meticulous attention to detailing in not only the production of the main incision, but also of the side port incisions. You don't want something that's too narrow that results in difficult instrumentation, or too wide that results in a shallow chamber. Insufflation of the globe should be just enough to flatten the anterior capsule, not overpressurize the globe. The capsulorhexis needs to be well-centered and of a size approximately 5 millimeters, something adequate enough to allow for ease of nuclear emulsification, yet small enough to allow for the placement of a sulcus IOL should that be required. The crucial step is the hydrodelineation, which actually creates the endonucleus, which is subsequently emulsified, but also creates the epinuclear barrier, which supports the PC. Nuclear emulsification should be with low flow settings and with minimal manipulations in the bag, followed by a visco-BSS exchange. Then we perform a hydro-visco delineation of the epinucleus up to the posterior pole, which allows for loosening of the epinucleus, which is then subsequently removed, again in very gentle settings, with the epinucleus mode of the ultrasound. Again, at the end of this, we do a visco-BSS exchange to prevent shallowing of the chamber. Then we perform an IA. Now, the irrigation aspiration, according to me, I prefer with a bimanual IA because it allows for circumferential removal of the cortex. What's very important to remember is that when you then plan to remove the viscoelastic, when you plan to then remove the source of irrigation in the eye, as you see here, you always do a visco-BSS exchange. The IOL insertion in these cases, again, needs to be done gently under a viscoelastic barrier. Make sure that the removal of the viscoelastic should not entail vigorous rock and roll movements of the IOL. If you do need to wash behind it, I tend to lift up the optic anteriorly with the aspiration and wash gently with the irrigation behind. And finally, I do not bring the irrigation out. I hydrate the main and the side port incisions the best I can, and then finally remove the source of irrigation and do a quick hydro of the last wound. Now, since the nuclei are different, so also the nucleus management strategies may also be different in these polar cataracts. And here are a few. Typically, we end up operating on cataracts with fairly early nuclear sclerosis. So a cataract like this, having done the hydro delineation, literally in the foot pedal 2 or in the epinucleus mode, you can just end up aspirating the entire nucleus gently in the central part with minimum manipulations in the bag, followed by a visco-BSS exchange. Here's another case. So you do the hydro delineation. Here the nucleus pops up. If it pops up, you take advantage of the fact that it's popped up, and you go ahead and aspirate the cataract. Now, as the cataracts get generally a little denser in the center, here again, it's a pretty soft cataract. Having delineated the endonucleus, you've lifted it up, and now you do a tilt and chop. You hold it and you just keep chopping, after which the epinucleus is removed. The next case of, again, of nucleus management, you can see the surgeon actually thinks it's pretty soft and attempts to just hold on to it and bring it up. It doesn't happen. So then the surgeon ends up doing a sculpt. Having sculpted out a little groove, you then hold and do a chop. Now, it is a lateral separation, a chop in situ with a minimum lateral separation, and then without rotating, you do another chop on either side, create the fragments. Once you've created the fragments, you bring the fragments out. Now you're good to actually either rotate the nucleus, or literally the one end, one half, and the other half are then elevated and then subsequently emulsified with a phaco 2 with settings which are suitable for that particular case. Now, as the cataracts get harder, when you're doing a hydrodelineation, it may be a little challenging, but having achieved the best hydrodelineation possible, again, you do a direct chop with a limited lateral separation. And here, either you chop, as I did in the previous case, a surgeon attempted lifting up the fragment, didn't really come up, gone to the other side, done a tiny chop, removed a fragment, after which the subsequent emulsification is literally like any other case. So the main thing is just keep your settings controlled and keep it gentle. Now, having seen the ideal technique, here are a few things that you definitely do not do. One, in this particular case, I'm just giving you a few examples. The chamber is actually shallowing because the tunnel is so short that during IA, there is a constant egressive fluid. Now, this would not happen if you did take care to make a nice shaved incision. Second, even by mistake, even accidentally, even forgetfully, you never, like in this case, the surgeon actually accidentally does a hydrodissection. Now, that has the propensity of having the wave go right behind and open up the posterior capsule. When you are doing a direct horizontal chop, especially for the slightly harder cataracts, you never do this. You never have such a wide separation, lateral separation. In this case, the surgeon has such a wide lateral separation, then actually yanks the nucleus around, which would otherwise be safe in a normal cataract, then performs the second chop. And finally, when he attempts to now rotate the nucleus to do the third chop, he notices that just those maneuvers have resulted in opening up of the posterior capsule. So the other mistake here is the surgeon attempts, this is a video from over 6 years ago, wherein a 26 number needle is introduced into the plas planner with a view of trying to save those fragments and bring them up. Today, I would state that this is definitely a no-no. Any introduction of a needle to try and save the nucleus from going down is going to cause significant damage to the vitreous base with a propensity of creating holes, tears, a detachment and a macular edema later. So this should also be avoided. And finally, as I mentioned throughout this course, when you are doing either a phaco or a IA like seen here, at the end, whenever your source of irrigation is coming out, you have to be ready with the visco on the other hand. This is another mistake where at the end of the IA, the surgeon has just introduced both the instruments. And finally, even when you're removing the visco at the end of visco wash after the IOL is inserted, you can actually see the IOL lifting up if you've not done a hydro of the wound, and therefore it should be avoided. I now come to the last part of my talk where we address the open posterior capsule, different scenarios, and the way they can be managed in a polar cataract. So the case one is you see when the nucleus is being emulsified. At the end of nuclear emulsification, you can see that little white ring underneath. Now that is not an opening in the posterior capsule, but however, it is just a condensation of the posterior cortex, which is fairly typical, and I've seen it very often. On the other hand, when you actually see this, you can actually see a bowing of fish mouthing, which signifies an open posterior capsule. Here, towards the second half of IA, the surgeon notices the typical, you know, elliptical equator to equator and opening in the posterior capsule. But since there is no vitreous disturbance, the surgeon is able to even put a one-piece Zeiss lens carefully in the confines of the back after using a dispersive viscoelastic before the injection. Here, everything's going well, but you can notice the typical fish mouthing towards the end of nuclear removal, which signifies that there is an opening. The surgeon does the right thing by doing a visco-BSS exchange, however, notices it spontaneously enlarges. So the surgeon then performs a limited anterior vitrectomy after having cleared the vitreous in the disturbed area with a cut IA. With the IA cut mode, the surgeon then goes ahead and removes all the cortex in a circumferential manner, first from this side and then the other, after which an IOL is placed. The next is a case where you can see a pupillary snap happening, and the surgeon notices that in this grade 3 polar cataract, there seems to be a propensity of the pupil of the nucleus dropping. So the surgeon brings the nucleus into the AC, but this again today is what I would suggest is not a good idea because the corneal endothelium, I mean, the support is of the small pupil, but it's best just letting it drop and managing it later on. Here's a heart cataract, a patient with a grade 3 nuclear sclerosis. Emulsification seems to be going well, and then the surgeon notices the last fragment, which is still in the bag, is now starting to sink. So what you don't do is you don't go after it. Put in some dispersive viscoelastic. The surgeon emulsifies the last bit of nucleus, after which a visco-BSS exchange is done. Everything was done well. Still, there was a disturbance in the vitreous for which a limited anterior vitrectomy was done, after which we did not have a three-piece lens. We extended it to a 5 mm and put in a rigid lens in the sulcus, after which, before you hand over to the retina surgeons, you make sure you tighten all the incisions. And that's my last video. You never do a capsule polish in patients with a polar cataract because there still is a propensity of a rent. Now here there's been a localized opening with the help of an intraocular forceps. It's converted to a round circular opening, after which the surgeon actually places a three-piece lens in the careful confines of the capsular bag. And finally, it's not over till it's over. Even a stromal hydration has the propensity in a polar cataract to result in a disruption of the posterior capsule, which is seen here. The patient, the surgeon actually didn't notice this, a friend's video, and at the end saw it the next day. With this, I come to the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for a patient hearing.
Thank you very much, Dr. Suvira. Just one question, what are your thoughts on flacs in posterior polar cataracts? Because a lot of talk has been there on the advantages of flacs.
Okay, so my experience with that is limited. However, I think if you're careful with respect to where you create your breaks, how you define what your endonucleus is. Once you've got that measurement right and you define, one, of course, the rexus is going to be perfect, round, centered, wherever you want it to be. The only challenge is whether you end up damaging the posterior capsule. So all the rest of the steps, like removal of the epinucleus and all, would be the same like in manual. But if you can define with your flacs what should be your endonucleus where you make your breaks, then you should
be okay. Yes, definitely we can. Actually, as you said rightly, the rexus is the most perfect and most consistent. And beyond that, you can actually optimize your settings so that you can increase your epinuclear shell and the cushioning is better. Yes. So that gives a greater safety, and on during the femto you can actually see with the OCT whether there is a pre-existing posterior capsular dehiscence. So that also helps.
Or at any point you're creating an intraoperative dehiscence.
Yeah, okay, when you're doing the femto you can see, because as the OCT is going on you can actually scan and you can see that. So that is another advantage.
And I think it would be even more advantageous in a more denser cataract, because in these denser cataracts it's a little challenging getting the hydro delineation
right.
Always an accident, a chance of it going behind. So, in that, I think it would.
So, because you can't rotate and you can't hydro dissect, so this gives the advantage even in that. Dr. Abhay Vasavda has also postulated the theory of his femto delineation, where they make cylindrical nuclear pieces.
So, what I feel is that there is a pneumatic dissection.
Yeah.
Area.
Then you get a pneumatic delineation. Then when you inject fluid, the fluid finds that space.
And creates that.
Yeah. So the biggest advantage in flacs is that there's a pneumatic dissection.
Yeah.
Whenever you do any hydro procedure, it finds that space and gets the fluid there rolling.
Correct.
So you don't need to create another space and you're far away from the posterior.
And you've actually measured where it has to be.
Yeah, so normally if you have the posterior settings as 500, here you would keep it at 900 or 1000 microns.
Thank you.
Thanks, that was